Ham Radio Now, episode 175. Bruce Perens, K6BP, and his Algoram digital voice server from the 2014 ARRL and TAPR Digital Communications Conference. I'm Kerry Pierce, KN4AQ. Algoram digital voice server is the title of his talk, but I'm going to revise it a little bit and pretty much just call it digital voice for VHF and UHF, because Bruce is going to talk about a lot of different things. He'll talk about Algoram, which is his company coming up. So Bruce Perens is back, the second talk at the DCC. We've heard from Bruce many times on Ham Radio Now and at the DCC talking about FreeDV. FreeDV is the digital voice program primarily used for HF. Well, I should say used on sideband. And that can be any place. It can be on HF, VHF, and UHF, any place you can do sideband. He's also talked about white box and the HT of the future. No, I need to say it like this. HT of the future. I do it with feedback, with echo, but I forgot to set up the mixer for that. So, sorry. Do that next time. Next time we do the HT of the future. It turns out that FreeDV, used for HF or VHF anyway on sideband, is not the ideal program for using codec 2-based digital voice on the HT of the future. Not what we were expecting. Well, Bruce is going to explain why, and he'll talk about that startup company, Algoram, that will be developing software that will do the job of putting codec 2 and FreeDV on HT of the future. All that is going to begin in a couple of minutes after I have thanked the hams who paid me to go out to Austin and record all this stuff and then come back here and to get it online for you. We did it with a Kickstarter and 108 hams who contributed between $10 and $150 as individuals, and that covered about half of the $8,000 goal. The rest of it came in bigger chunks, $500 a chunk, from our corporate underwriters. And it starts with these guys.
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. John C. Dvorak is KJ6LNG. But this is not another one of those ham radio podcasts. They take on politics, the media, entertainment, anything they want. Sometimes they do say something nice about ham radio. Everybody else, pretty much trashed. They are live on the internet on Sundays and Thursdays, and you can get them at noagendashow.com. Find out what time the show is on live. They get it online for you to download or play as a podcast as soon as Adam gets it uploaded. He works very hard to get it going really quickly, so you get it later on that day. So find them at the No Agenda Show or just noagendashow.com. We're also brought to you by TAPR. TAPR sponsors the DCC. If you're interested in anything digital in ham radio, hardware, software, data, voice, television, you'll be at home in TAPR. If you're getting a lot out of these DCC videos and you're not already a TAPR member, well, consider joining. Stop by their website, TAPR.org, and check them out. We are brought to you by several hams who would encourage you to look at these guys, hackersforcharity.org. Now, you guys know that the term hacker really means people who love to dig into their computers and software and make them do cool things, not necessarily orthodox things, you know, sometimes a little bit unusual, but not necessarily evil, the way hackers have gotten a reputation in the general media. Hackers for Charity was founded by Johnny Long. You might have heard of him. He figured out that he and you could use your hacking skills to help out people all around the world who really need you but can't begin to afford you. So maybe you can help. Find out how at hackersforcharity.org. We're brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force, and they are at aretf.org. I am able to see this webpage that I'm showing you, and you can watch this video, because there are standards on the internet. This isn't news, especially for this audience, but it's also not news that in amateur radio, especially in digital and the networking, standards are harder to find. So Brian, K7UDR, and his pal Kenny, KU7M, launched ARRETF. It's patterned after the IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. A guiding principle is that you can't tell people, especially hams, what to do. You've got to form a consensus, and then maybe most people will adopt a standard formed from that general agreement. They're just getting started. If you think they're onto something and you'd like to help, or maybe just see what they're up to, check out the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force at arretf.org. And we are brought to you by that enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper, who still wishes to remain anonymous. He's sticking to his guns here. He's been a regular attendee at the DCC for over 30 years, very enthusiastic about what Tapper and the DCC and Ham Radio Now are able to do together. And so maybe you're watching these programs from the DCC and you didn't get in on the Kickstarter and you want to help. Well, you can. The Kickstarter paid the bills for the DCC videos. Just barely. But Ham Radio Now is an ongoing production that depends on your support. So stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. You'll see Arvin sitting back there. You'll see his icon, the piggy bank. Click on him. He will take you to our contribution page where you can use PayPal or a credit card. They'll kind of lean you toward PayPal since it is PayPal, but stick to your guns if you want to use a credit card, and you'll be able to do that. My thanks to everybody who supports Ham Radio Now through the Kickstarter or through the website. So thank you very much. And now let's head on back to Austin, Texas, September 5th, 2014. Here's Tapper President Steve Bible, N7HPR, to reintroduce Bruce Perens.
I'd like to introduce Bruce Perens again, K6BP, and his talk on the algorithm. Is it algorithm?
Algoram.
Algoram, digital voice server, a platform for digital voice development. Take it away, Bruce.
So Algoram is a company that Chris Testa and I are building, and it's sort of, we took the words for algorithm and radio and mobile and stuck them together and came up with Algoram. And so I was listed as providing the backup talk, which is the talk that you can actually still hear if you manage to kill one of the later speakers, which is Boat Anchor 101, building a complete engineering laboratory on the cheap. The bad news is that the flight is full and they are all here, so there won't be any need for the backup. So I'll tell you where you can see it. The Sandark conference is next weekend in San Diego, and Chris and I will be doing a demo, and I will do the Boat Anchor talk, and I'll do this talk. Pacificon, October in Santa Clara, I'm going to do the Boat Anchor, the demo, and this talk. And Orlando Hamcation, these have been submitted for February 2015, but not yet accepted. So what is digital voice server? Well, it comes out of some frustration that I had with FreeDV, and this is how I'm working it out. It's a general purpose digital voice program. It's designed to be extensible to all possible digital voice protocols, but I started with one, which is FreeDV and Codec 2, so it should interoperate with the FreeDV program. Its immediate application is to go where FreeDV hasn't gone before. It is to run in HT of the future, which is what I'm calling our hardware product based on white box, but will run in all sorts of platforms. And of course, this Northwest Digital thing could run it on its Linux server. So about me, I went to communication arts school, which is where you send the people who can't do math. And I started writing computer programs to run a radio station on the college campus, and later on to do feature film computer graphics. And I've always been the operating systems programmer rather than the signal processing programmer. I am a Unix kernel programmer since 1981, and thus a Linux kernel programmer these days. I've written bit slice microcode at Pixar, where we had very specialized image processing engines before we got to the point where you could buy a processor from Intel that was faster and did the same thing. And I'm one of the founders of the open source movement in software. This is following the footsteps of Richard Stallman, who had something called Free Software before then. I founded No Code International, certainly not the first person to talk about ending the code requirement, but perhaps a little easier to follow than Wayne Green, et cetera. So I'm going to tell you now about the corruption of an innocent engineering type. I wrote the licensing rules for open source because I had to make the Debian Linux distribution, and I had questions about what went in it and what didn't. Because of this, I got involved in intellectual property and was corrupted by the fact that you can make incredible amounts of money if you help lawyers out and bill essentially what they do. And so today I help companies and their attorneys deal with software licensing. That's not just open source licensing. They bring me in because I know about the open source, and then we find out that they are not in compliance with 20 or 30 commercial contracts for the proprietary software that they're using, et cetera. So I run a rescue service for large corporations that have found their way into copyright infringement because some engineer did not understand, or their manager, what they were including and how to do it, and there was not sufficient due diligence to prevent that from happening. And I help companies structure their processes so that that doesn't happen again. I help them understand how to get into compliance, and if necessary, I rewrite the infringing software to be non-infringing. So that's been fun. It allows me to spend a good deal of my month not working on it and working on building Algoram and making open source software and not taking anyone's venture capital investment so far. So the value of the company builds up before we actually have to take someone's money. So I've done a lot of thinking about the future of amateur radio. So I worked on No Code, I worked on open source and Linux. I evangelized Codec 2 and Digital Voice. I've worked on various FCC and ITU regulations. Most recently opposing encryption on the amateur band, successfully evangelizing others to do it, and dragging a reluctant ARRL into the fight. They had said they weren't going to file on the issue, and they ended up doing so. And most recently building open and extensible radio transceivers, which is helping Chris Testa with White Box. So if you want to do strategy to make a product that sells or to change the way people think, you need to put a lot of pieces together and make a big picture. So there are human factors, motivations, aesthetics. What is it that makes people lust after a product the way that Apple sells it? You know, people just don't buy Apple because they need it. They buy it because it's beautiful and they fall in love with it at first sight. Okay, can we do that kind of thing with a product? How to operate your customer relationships. These are all things you have to think about in making a product. Economics is the way that we model needs and the way they are fulfilled and the transactions that define all of that. Law, so we have FCC, we have ITAR, which is munitions export in the United States. These devices are munitions. They are not necessarily legal to export, especially if they do encryption. But actually, certain kinds of radio are considered munitions by the government. Copyright, patent, contract law. Then finally, we get to technology. So just doing the technology doesn't cut it. So my role in the genesis of Codec 2 and FreeDV was mainly to be an evangelist. So Jean-Marc Vallon, the Speaks author, introduced me to David Rowe, and eventually David decided to work on the project. I had evangelized to him and created Codec 2 from his old PhD thesis code. Dave Witten and Dave Rowe created FreeDV. And I'm still relatively innumerate by the standards of this crowd, so I won't be writing the modems and codecs myself. And I've gotten so frustrated with this that I've gone back to math review. And Pixar never drove me to do that in actually 19 years in computer graphics. I never bothered to learn what was necessary for signal processing. So you can tell I'm more frustrated now than I ever was then. So in my world, hackers, I'm a hacker. Hackers are the folks who make innovative software, not the ones who break your computer. Those are called computer criminals. So at first, I didn't, oh, whatever. I thought crackers were guys from the South, but maybe I shouldn't say that. And, okay, but at first I didn't have time to work on FreeDV programming. Later on, I found that the software was not well suited for hacking, extending and modification. And this is not to speak ill of David's work, it's just that it wasn't designed for what I wanted it to do. So David Rowe himself noted recently that the FreeDV software, and I quote, just grew, and that it shows it. So making something easier to hack, I started thinking of making a program that was really strong on architecture, framework, and modularity, so that it would be easier to extend and modify. It would have no framework dependencies on FreeDV or Codec 2, but would include them, and it would support any codec or modem, so things like AMBI and D-Star, etc. And off with its head, FreeDV is GUI only, and I wanted to support embedded systems, so cut off that GUI and make it a headless monitor server. I also wanted to support radical GUIs, for example, a web server interface using WebDAV. And this is the way that in the modern internet standard that's developing, you run full duplex audio and video connection over a web server. Well, gee, if you can run a full duplex audio and video connection with a web page, isn't that the front panel of your radio, including the microphone and the speaker? Okay, so WebDAV is going to be an important thing for our future. I wanted to support Linux, Mac, and Windows as FreeDV does today, and add iPad, iPhone, and Android. The GUI portability layer we used for the desktop WX widgets wasn't up to the task of supporting phones. Native GUIs are best for that, but that means a separate GUI for each platform. The audio portability layer that FreeDV uses didn't support the necessary platforms and drivers, and was kind of nasty, actually, in that it imposed its own paradigm on the programmer. It had its own event loop, and it was really hard to implement pull either using it or aside from it. They sort of put it in as an afterthought recently, but it wasn't quite up to the task. So isn't making all of this a lot of work? Well, hell yes. Achieving all of the goals I have is work for more than one person. I'm not ready to pay for other people's work up front. If I get lucky with my company, I might be able to pay some people later on, or I might go broke. You know, other people in this room have made companies and gone broke. A few of them have actually made money, but in general, one in five businesses succeeds. Okay, so I can't make promises that I'm not able to keep. So open source would be important. And of course, when you work on any large program, intellectual property raises its ugly head. iPhone and iPod, in this case, have their own legal requirements because Apple won't admit the GPL license that we would otherwise use to its App Store. And we wanted to have that. Okay, Apple would like you to use the BSD license, and I'd learned firsthand that BSD licensing is for chumps. It's a free gift to the world's richest companies without any return to the developer. Indeed, I submit that BSD licensing was in part responsible for the Heartbleed disaster. Okay, this was a security program that broke every important program, including Quicken. Okay, every big company, like Microsoft and Intuit, used the OpenSSL code in their products, and that was under this BSD license. But because the license is essentially a gift, it doesn't ask for anything back. None of them, not one, actively supported its maintenance. So yeah, it got a security bug that broke practically everything important in the whole world. The economic incentives created by that license are wrong. That's the problem. So here I am. I had to figure out how to be open source, not a chump using BSD licensing, and acceptable to Apple. So I started to think about dual licensing strategies. This means using one of the more restrictive open source licenses and also offering a commercial license to those who wish to pay for it. But I had to make all of this fair to the developers. And it's not just for hams. We're working on this product to satisfy mission-critical communications needs for first responders, not just radio amateurs. Because, folks, that's where the money is. You guys are the early adopters. You're the developers. You're the ones who help get companies like this on their feet, but you're not the ones that we can actually feed our families and send our children to college on. So we go into land mobile communications. So there were performance and reliability requirements beyond those of the radio amateur world. So in general, open source is the result of one person creating a program that's useful. And only once people have a motivation to use it does the community come in and start extending it. Because until it's useful, they don't have any reason to participate in it. So I decided to make back-end software without a GUI. My software would run on the command line, and others could place a GUI front end on it. So separating the front end and the back end solve a lot of problems that the present FreeDV code cannot. These are real-time permissions, memory issues, internet working problems, GUI separation issues, and battery use issues. These all fall out of separating the front end and the back end. So how's that happen? We have a requirement that the audio that comes in the microphone go to the transmitter without breaks and with minimal delay. We call that kind of delay latency. And of course, the receive path is a mirror of that. It needs to have the same short latency. Similarly, the push-to-talk input and the transceiver keying output must be closely coupled in time and synchronized with the audio. Well, on a real operating system, that's actually kind of hard. David Rowe has noticed that his embedded smart mic product performs with less latency than the same software on a real operating system. And the reason is that the OS and the portability layers impose their own delays unless you do extra work to avoid it. A heavily loaded desktop OS can keep your program from running for an arbitrarily long delay, long enough for unacceptable performance. This would manifest as stutter. If you've ever tried to do VoIP on a system that has other stuff running, you've probably heard this. Not acceptable when the cops are running your software. Okay? FreeDV only runs adequately on unloaded desktops that have CPU time and memory to spare, especially memory. So we had to run at a guaranteed performance on servers, regardless of the CPU and memory load. We'd have to use real-time scheduling system calls to get a guarantee of sufficient access to the CPU. We'd have to lock down memory so that we were impervious to swap or paging delays. This is how your system extends memory to cover more things than you actually have memory for, swap and paging. So we couldn't do these things if the GUI program was part of the real-time program, because the GUI required too many resources to get real-time services and lockdown RAM. And most of the Windows systems we had to use did not themselves provide any real-time guarantees. So we had to separate the two pieces into separate processes. In order to provide real-time service to the audio push-to-talk input and keying output services, we had to bypass the Windows system and access them directly. To do this, we had to use system administrator privileges that weren't appropriate to give to a GUI program. But for security reasons, anything that operates in an elevated privilege should be as small as possible. That way you have a hope of managing any potential security problems in the code. If it gets too big, you'll never find them all. We don't require root privileges for the program, but we do require some of the newer POSIX fine-grained privileges, or their equivalents on other operating systems. On Linux, we have a script that you have to install that sets permissions appropriately on game controllers, etc., because the default in Linux is to make them root only and then hand them out via the Windows system, which we're not using. We have to be careful, however, not to grant the same privileges on keyboards or mice, as these would enable key logging security attacks. If you have a wireless keyboard, you should consider its security, because when you type your password on that, that's going over the radio. Okay, is it encrypted? You probably don't even know. A common case is to have a Raspberry Pi or other embedded system controlling the radio and connected to the rest of the world by an Ethernet cable or Wi-Fi. The GUI goes on a different computer. So obviously, having separate front-end and back-end was important to this. All modern battery-operated computers optimize battery use by having the CPU sleep for most of the time. It's awakened by an interrupt when I/O is ready for processing. So it was essential that our program not busy loop. Busy looping eats batteries and deprives other programs of access to the CPU. What other program is it depriving? Your GUI. Okay, so you have to... You're getting top services on that CPU because you've asked for real-time services, but you have to stand aside for other programs to run as well. And safety. Don't leave the transmitter on if something breaks. So the generally accepted way to sleep until I/O is ready on an operating system is to use the POSIX poll system call, or its equivalent on non-POSIX systems. And we had to have all I/O devices, files, and network or inter-process communications available in one poll loop. In order to have poll, to have fine real-time support and optimal control of devices, native audio interfaces rather than portability layers were necessary. They'd have to be very modular because we'd have to re-implement them on Android, Windows, iPad, etc. Fortunately, many of the platforms have POSIX and other interfaces in common, so we don't have to do this for everything. ALSA, the native audio interface on Linux, is difficult to program and less stable than expected. It required a lot of tuning. Android uses a different audio driver from ALSA on Linux, even though Android is based on Linux. Similarly, we need native drivers for push-to-talk input, keying output, network I/O, and all of this would have to be very modular and easy to change. I wanted to have the ability to mix and match, thank you, codecs and modems, so they have to be modular. And I created an object called a framer, which encapsulated the job of wrapping the codec output in a protocol frame, and adding non-voice data from other sources as necessary, and passing the result onto the modem. And of course, we do the reverse for receive. Modern modems determine both a symbol and an error distance for the symbol. I'd actually like to have a generalized way to communicate that information. I do not yet. I'd like to have a generalized way for modems to represent their configuration, the number of symbols, the frame size, the data rate, the timing, to other software. I don't have that yet. So what I just do is exchange binary data between things and hope that they use the same number of bits and the same same data types, etc. So I need guidance on generalizing that interface. So I wrote this in C++, specifically C++ 11. C++ 14 is now ratified. I didn't use every possible C++ feature because some of them are rather low performance. I used lambdas. Lambdas turned out to be very convenient. If you're used to C, this is going to be a little hard to parse in your head. Is this a function call and a couple lines of code? No. You'll notice the closed parenthesis for the function call is all the way here. And the brace is actually part of an argument. So what this is a function pointer with no name. This little magic here is how you import variables into this block from the block outside of it. But this actually makes C++ a good deal more powerful, in my opinion, than it was before. So we did insist on having those, and that is going to mean that we require a minimum GCC version, or Clang. Clang is the other compiler on distributions. I looked at other languages, but Java wasn't suitable for various reasons. Nothing else had the support that C++ did. So designing all of this, there'd have to be a base class common to all devices that support poll for that big I/O loop. There'd be a subclass for each sort of device, audio input, audio output, PTT input, keying, output, etc. And each one of them would actually only have a few simple methods. So they have a method that passes out the data that you need to run the poll loop. They have a method that tells you if they're ready. And they have their I/O method, which is read or write. And that's really everything that's in the class methods, except for the constructors and the destructors. And these, each driver, I/O, codec, modem, framer, would be a subclass implementing those methods. You'd only need to learn the methods of that class to implement any new driver. And every type of driver would have a no-op version that would be a skeleton for new development. It would be what you started from when writing. And also, sometimes you actually want things to be no-op. For example, if you want to get the modem data directly out to a file for debugging, you would make the codec no-op or something like that. The drivers self-register. Each file that contains a driver has a static constructor, which just calls a registration function. So there is no pre-filled out table of all of the protocols and drivers that are available to you. What happens is you link them together, or you can runtime load them together, and that defines what you have. And that's really important to implement a app store for modes, because the drivers can be installed on the computer separately from the program. When you start the program, it just goes out and looks in a directory for them, collects them all, links them into itself, and starts running. So you could, for example, install DSTAR into the system after it was already on the disk. So this is a partial class diagram. All of these things actually have subclasses. So there's a base class, there's a codec class, a frame error, a forward error correction class, a framer class to generate protocol formatting, an I/O device, a messaging is just error messages, and a modem class. So those are the top level classes. And then you see audio device fans out. I'm sorry, I/O device fans out into audio device, keying output, PTT input, text, and user interface is how we would talk to a complex GUI. And indeed, audio device further fans out into audio input and audio output. So going to the audio class, so we have the base class, the I/O device class, so pole is defined in here. Here's audio devices, input and output, and here we have some devices that I've written. So here is ALSO, which is the Linux audio input. This is file descriptor. That means that you can feed a pipe or socket to the program and it will get audio from there or put audio out to it. This is a tone generator for testing. And this takes the file descriptor and makes it into a file. So these things are very easy to generalize. None of these interfaces took all that long to write. And that's the benefit of a good architecture design, is when you go to extend it, it's really trivial to do so. So this is a similar design for push-to-talk input. We have our I/O device where it knows about polling. We have the push-to-talk input base class. And then we have our specializations of that. So this uses Linux event device, which is how we get all of the USB devices and the buttons on your computer. These all come in through these interface. This, again, we can get them through a file descriptor. So that can be a socket or a pipe or a net connection of some type. And this one is just constant for testing. So this says, keep the push-to-talk on or off until I stop the program. And again, you can add to this very trivially. The software endeavors to catch all possible harmful signals and exceptions and turn off the transmitter. The last step of this is to have a watchdog timer in the hardware, because even though my code tries to catch everything possible, it doesn't have any way to stop you from pulling the plug on the computer. Okay, and in that case, the actual transmit hardware should realize that it's not getting heartbeats from the program and should eventually turn off the transmitter. So this is a command line to run this. We do not expect to have humans type this. We expect it to be sent to the program from a GUI program that's controlling it. So what's happening here is we're saying the digital push-to-talk device is this particular USB device, and we have a way for you to discover what all the USB devices are, button number 260, and that the push-to-talk for SSB is another button on the same device. I'm testing, so I provide a 400 hertz tone at 1/4 of the total possible audio level. I'm using ALSA loudspeaker, the default loudspeaker on the system for the transmitter in this test. Here I'm using the FreeDV protocol. FDMDV is a sort of legacy name for it. I'm using the Codec 2 codec. And I'm using the default microphone on the system. So these things are very easy to select. And we enumerate them. So you can run this program in a way that just prints out what all of the possibilities are in a way that your GUI program can parse. So we can use any button on any USB device, the laptop buttons, etc., as a PTT. That has to be rewritten when you get off of Linux because it's different on Windows, but we have some generic USB human interface device code that might work on other platforms. We've not yet tested it. So this is my favorite push-to-talk device. This is a Contour Design Shuttle Express. You can buy it on Amazon. It's actually made for video editing, but it has a nice dial that you could use for tuning, and it has buttons that you can use for push-to-talk. And this is my other favorite. This is a dictation transcriber pedal. There are actually three switches. This is one, and this is one. So once I had written the EB dev code, putting those on was trivial. It just worked for everyone. It worked for the button on top of my video camera, worked for everything. So about the size of this program, it would not fit in David's SDR1000 smart mic that David Rowe is designing and other STM32F4 programs. At least I don't think so. The FreeDV API that David wrote and a dedicated program are better for those. It would fit just fine in the Raspberry Pi. About the Raspberry Pi, it's not our favorite program because the CPU documentation is still incomplete and proprietary to Broadcom. The CPU board, though, is $35. That's hard to beat. The Sorensen audio board, which is required because Pi only has an audio output, and you need an input, well, that's $35 also. But when you put all of this stuff together, you get a nice computer for a little more than $100 that can be a complete remote rig controller. It can run ham, lib, server, etc. It's cheaper and more powerful than the smart mic, but it's missing the user interface factors. It's cheaper and more functional than Rig Blaster Blue. I think I paid more than $200 for Rig Blaster Blue. If I wanted to use Ethernet or Wi-Fi, I'd be much closer to $100 on this. Licensing the software is a Faro GPL 3. It's the most restrictive open source license I can find. It is just fine for people who want to be free. A commercial license is available. And because there are two licenses, this requires that I get copyright assignment or the right to relicense from people who contribute code directly to the program. It doesn't make that requirement of people who write the GUI, because the GUI is a separate program. It is not, in copyright terms, a derivative work of my program. So you can make a GUI free or proprietary, I don't care, it's a separate program. There's a covenant back to contributors to make that copyright assignment part fair. If you assign to me, I covenant back that for 3 years I will keep the development free, or I will take your contribution back out of it. And so I am hoping that the fact that you get someone who's paid working on maintenance for those 3 years is a good compensation for the code contribution that you're making. So I'm trying to have a fair quid pro quo for both free and paid uses where the commercial licenses support the free development. This stuff is all economics. Licensing really falls out to economics. And when people can't make sense of open source licensing, it's because they're not coming to it through an economic perspective. They pick the wrong license. They don't understand how it works for them. They don't understand the benefits, etc. So where is a commercial license necessary? In the Apple App Store, that's Apple's decision, not mine. Commercial products where GPL terms are not desired. any use of proprietary codecs and modems that are software. So if you have a free driver for a proprietary chip like the one we just heard about, that's okay under the GPL, but if you have software AMBI, for example, and you've licensed the patents, et cetera, you have to pay me too. That's only fair. We'll support proprietary codecs, but the makers of proprietary drivers must buy a license. The software will reject the proprietary driver without the license, and we have a good legal reason for you not to change that, even though the GPL is there. The first GUI is under development by me using the SHOES GUI framework. Has anyone ever heard of the SHOES GUI? Okay, written by a mad genius named Y the Lucky Stiff. That's not a typo. He has an underbar on the front of his name. And it's the easiest program, the easiest GUI to program by far. Runs on the X window system, maybe other platforms, and requires the Ruby interpreter. I am writing it mainly as a demo. This GUI is not meant for mission-critical use, but it's fine for hams and as a first example of what can be done. And Y made this for a programming education tool called Hackety Hacks that had to be very easy to program. And then Y removed his entire internet presence. We still don't know why. And others are going forward with support for the software. We were able to find recent backups of his work and restore it. Communication with the GUI is platform dependent, but in general will be through file descriptors using POL. These can be pipes, sockets, or files, so the GUI can be local or remote. Works the same way pretty much either way. WebDAV potentially allows driver-free complete transmit receive control from a browser, including full duplex audio. The formal W3C standard is in development. Dave Witten has expressed interest in WebDAV and is currently experimenting with WebSockets. Is that right, Dave? Yeah, WebRTC. And did I use the wrong? Yes, I used the wrong acronym. It's WebRTC, it's not WebDAV. Okay, so that's another Bruce's wrong moment. And, okay, and then that's good because I have to give this speech three more times. And so since he's working on WebRTC, we now call him WebDave. And, okay, so I've deliberately designed a larger porting cost into this program than exists in FreeDV in order to have finer control over I/O and better real-time services, but we'll pay the cost. The program's too large for the smaller embedded processors, but it's just fine for anything that would be in a phone, etc. So some of my experience, and I think I have about 4 minutes left. I'm going to use up all the Q&A time. The compiler static analysis was very useful in finding coding bugs, but I had to be anal retentive about my coding. So when you do char star const x, if you try to implement the increment the pointer instead of the value, the compiler will tell you. So I do a lot of this stuff, and you can see a line of code where it's const this or that const something const, and that gets programmers kind of annoyed. Clang, the other compiler, is now useful alongside of GCC. It has special static analysis that you have to run separately from compilation that points out some bugs ignored by GCC. This software has to run for years on end without a restart in a mission-critical role. And to do that, it must have no leaks of allocated memory that would lead to slowly using up all of the system's memory over time. You know about all those things that you have to reboot because they do that, okay? Valgrind is a wonderful tool for memory leaks, but to use it, you must clean up everything it complains about, even the ones that you don't think are important, or you won't see the messages about the other ones. Doxygen, I guess that's how it's pronounced, was used as a documentation system. The programmer writes structured comments into the program, and it processes these into well-formatted web pages and class diagrams like the one you saw, all cross-linked. Oh, that's more time than I really have, but I'll take it all, Steve. And you can also generate printable PDF for a book from Doxygen. The revision control system is Git. That seems to be what everyone is using. I didn't use GitHub because I worry about too many things being in one place. Who will buy GitHub? Like DICE bought SourceForge. And is that right? Well, they bought Slashdot at least. And having GitHub's ads was not something that I wanted. It turned out that my Debian system would install a wonderful Git server and Git web interface with nearly no effort on my part. CMake was used as the build driver. AutoTools makes me tear my hair out, and I will never, ever touch it. Thank you. Google Test is the test framework. It became clear that some facilities would not ever have a chance of working until tests were written. No matter how confident I am of my own code, you've seen from my presentations that I get words wrong. I'm 51 and I have senior moments. So I've not been very responsible so far about test coverage, and this must be improved so that I can catch my own mistakes. But so far the program appears to work. Code and developer documentation are at algoram.com. There is no user documentation yet. So far, it is working with David's FreeDV API. I'm splitting that API into separate codec, modem, and framer. That is actually not a very big job, but I have to devote another day or two to it. And of course, it's not the only drag on my time. The GUI is not ready. The program works from the command line. You can push to talk on the command line. And the Linux release of the command line version of the program is imminent. It's not really ready that you'd want to use it on your station, but it's nice for looking at and experimenting at this time. And so I'm going to take questions and answers. Q&A right now, please.
Hi, Bruce. Earlier in your talk, you said WebDAV. I think you meant...
No, it's WebRTC.
WebRTC. You had WebDAV and on your slide, and you said WebDAV, I think.
Yeah, so, no, I
was scratching my head for, like, the next
few
slides.
No, I'm sorry about that, and it is unfortunately really easy to change one of those things to the other, especially when you're only half aware of what any of them do. The other day I told someone to use GlassFish when I meant for them to use some other Java thing, and you know, all the names are easy to get wrong.
I have a question for you. You had in there that this is licensed under the GPL3.
Afero.
What is the difference between the GPL3 and the Afero GPL3? I wasn't familiar with that.
So a long time ago, the free software mavens got together and considered what we would do about Google. And the reason was that all of our licenses triggered when you distributed the software, but Google only performed the software. It never actually distributed the software. So they could do internally whatever they wanted with the GPL and never give us anything back. And this was worrisome, although in reality, Google's been a pretty good partner. And so we added this thing called Afero. And Afero was actually a company owned by Henry Poole at the time that needed this feature. Afero says if you run this program as a software as a service, you have to provide some way to get its source code. And it is actually a patch for a legal problem or opportunity in the United States, which is that there is no public performance restriction for software. I could not publicly perform your music or play or show your film without paying for that public performance, but I can publicly perform your software. And so we had to sort of kludge the license up to catch that sort of thing so that this paradigm of sharing the source code to modifications would survive. Now, even though we do stuff like that, the GPL is not perfect and there are ways around it. And I've actually taught classes to lawyers that lasted all day about this, so you don't want to hear more about it. Any more questions? Yes.
I'm Thomas Cron, KT5TK. My question is, I appreciate all kind of different choices that you have, especially on Linux and wherever, but I was scratching my head, where exactly is your approach different from what we have already with GNU Radio?
This may actually be a little different from what the people who work on GNU Radio consider it, but I actually consider GNU Radio to be a prototyping tool and not a tool for employment in production. And there are a couple of reasons for this. One is resource use. One is efficiency of the couplings. And the other is sheer size. And so I did not just want to make a sketch and give that to the police in my town to use when we had an earthquake in California. So I made a separate piece of software instead. However, Chris Testa, who is working on Whitebox, uses GNU Radio extensively in designing and testing Whitebox. And Whitebox is a radio modem, essentially, to GNU Radio. It will do stuff with GNU Radio. So GNU Radio has its role. I just didn't feel that I should ask it to do things that I felt were not in its design, that it was never made to do so. All right, if we were to end right now, I think that would be just fine.
Okay,
so thank you very much,
Bruce. So that concludes today's presentations. We now segue into what's called playtime, otherwise known as playtime. And of course, you're welcome to be here in this room and socialize. You've got the demo room next door. Take a look at what everybody's got over there. There's some new things that have been set up just recently. At 5:30 is the social. As I mentioned, everybody's welcome to the social, and we'd love to have you. It'll be right out this door and right to the left. It's called the Limestone. I think you'll be able to find it right there, okay? So I'd like to see you at 5:30, but enjoy the rest of the evening.